So first, if I could, let me introduce the panelists who are here with me. Javier Ruiz is an activist in Peru. He works to protect the environmental reserve of Chaparri. He has created and managed an organization he works with, or let me say this, the organization that he works with is created and run and overseen by the local campesino community. And the area that they're trying to preserve, in theory, should be preserved because it's part of the national system of natural protected areas in Peru. Nonetheless, the area is at significant risk because of the work of illegal loggers and a hydroelectric project. And Javier Ruiz himself, who's a history teacher, history professor, has come under threat, and he'll talk about that. Selwyn Ajaro from the Solomon Islands is the coordinator of the Tawatana Community Conservation and Development Association, TCCDA. It works with to protect the environment, but also the rights of indigenous communities. And Selwyn works with tribal groups to address land ownership and recognition of land ownership for over tribal lands, and this has brought him into conflict with companies and other business interests in the region. Sharon Spurr, next, is an investigative reporter, and she has exposed the corrupt and problematic behavior of major players in the Israeli economy. She has been a reporter for Haaretz and The Marker, which is a business journal in the Haaretz group, which is, of course, one of the leading publications in Israel. And because of her work in particular, uncovering and documenting abuses by David Digme, I'm not sure if I'm saying the name right, but and because of other work, she has faced retaliation, and in particular, and she'll talk about this and I'll ask her about this, what's called a slap suit, which is strategic, it stands for S-L-A-P-P-P, strategic lawsuit against public participation, two P's actually, slap suit, seeking damages of nearly 1.7 million shekels, which is...
No, it's almost €1 million. Okay,
Altogether, so that was 400,000 euros, yeah. But now we're up to $1 million, yeah. €1 million in damages. And then finally, we'll hear from Ramani Kunanayagam, who has worked in oversight of corporations and businesses, in sustainability, and in human rights from, I think, the business and corporate perspective with the BG Group, but recently, at the end of last year, has begun a term on the World Bank inspection panel. So we'll have a discussion of oversight mechanisms, or one particular oversight mechanism to bring to our analysis of the risks that defenders run when they challenge corruption. And so before we begin, I would just like to say my name is Jim Cavallaro. I'm very pleased to be on the advisory board of Frontline. I've been involved with Frontline for nearly two decades with Andrew and Mary and others who are here. So I consider it a real privilege to be here in this space, which is the space globally for defense of human rights defenders. So it's a privilege for me to be associated with Frontline. And my background is mostly in human rights in Latin America, in the Inter-American Commission, and I now am the president of an organization called the University Network for Human Rights, which works to engage universities and students in practical human rights work around the world. What I wanted to start the debate with and the discussion, and we're going to be looking particularly at the issue of corruption as a driver of insecurity for human rights defenders, but I think it's important for us to take stock of the fact that corruption has not always been a central issue for human rights defenders. And I say this as a human rights defender with some regret, is that I think we, as the expression goes, came late to the party, as it were. We arrived late with human rights dynamics and a human rights focus to issues of corruption. And it has become apparent, I think, to me, but certainly more importantly to people in the field of human rights, that corruption is an essential element that works in a transversal sense in all sorts of situations of rights abuse. Because what all of us in human rights push for in different ways on different issues, environmental justice, racial justice, distribution of resources, access to medical services, it's whatever our issues are, and there are many, women's rights, indigenous rights, et cetera, inevitably there will come a moment where we will need or seek some intervention, some engagement by some authority to be done in a transparent, open, and fair way to respond to abuses. And that transparency and that oversight and that legitimacy of the action that we demand will not occur in corrupt spaces. And corruption is therefore inherently an enemy of all of what we do in human rights. I'm really happy that we have this panel. I'm glad that Frontline has provided this space. I would just say, and this is not our issue, that I think all of us in the field of human rights need to think more about how we should and could be engaging in the issue of corruption. And by engaging in the issue of corruption, expanding the field of partners, of those who would see then our work as work for transparency, decency, good governance, and issues that maybe some people might not think of as human rights issues, and maybe some people who are not self-described human rights advocates would think are important. So with that brief introduction, let me start, if I could, and I'd like to ask, I'll start with Javier, and the question I'll ask, and I'll just ask in Spanish, is tell us a bit about, in a few minutes, to contextualize your work, the areas in which your work has conflicted with interests, powerful interests, and how that has led, through your fight, has led to pushback or retaliation against you precisely for your work in challenging corruption. ¿No?
Entonces, ¿cómo que tu trabajo, no sé, ha entendido, te ha respondido a la corrupción y cuáles han sido las consecuencias para ti?
Okay. Bueno, voy a hablar en español. Muchas gracias a Frontline Defender por haberme invitado. Bueno, este tema para mí es relevante, muy importante, y de alguna manera creo que todos los peruanos, cualquier peruano podría hablar de esto, ya que la corrupción se ha convertido prácticamente en el tema más relevante, el que se habla en país en los últimos años. Thank you. Para darles una imagen, los últimos 5 presidentes del país, ¿no? Todos están procesados por corrupción, uno de ellos está preso, 2 están en proceso esperando ya sus juicios, uno de ellos está esperando extradición en Estados Unidos y uno de ellos se pegó un tiro en la cabeza cuando llegaba ya la Fiscalía de la Nación a detenerlo precisamente por estar involucrado en corrupción. Es un poco para poner el panorama general. Hay un pensador del siglo XIX que decía que en el Perú, donde es como un cuerpo enfermo, de donde se pone el dedo, salta la pus. Y precisamente eso es lo que he aprendido, y ahí un poco ya voy entrando al contexto local, en lo que he vivido, ¿no? O sea, aparentemente, lo que debería ser un modelo de gestión comunitaria en el cual un grupo de campesinos, de manera extraordinaria, generaron una reserva ecológica de autogestión campesina, que fue reconocida por el Estado del año 2001 y que se convirtió en la primera reserva ecológica de gestión campesina en el Perú, cuyo modelo ha servido para que muchas otras comunidades campesinas y nativas puedan generar lo que ahora se está llamando el ordenamiento territorial, es decir, definir su espacio y dedicarle espacios también para la conservación, pensando en el futuro. ¿No? Este modelo, que ha sido muy premiado, muy reconocido a nivel mundial, inclusive por sus proyectos de conservación de especies, de fauna, y que además de nuestro territorio, nuestra región, tiene más del 50% de área reservada. Si juntamos todas las reservas, esta reserva campesina tiene más del 50% del área en reserva. No recibe un sol de financiamiento del Estado, o un euro, no recibe ningún euro de financiamiento del Estado, todos se lo autogestionan, por ser de propiedad campesina, a pesar de todos los servicios ambientales que da. Bueno, este modelo que funcionaba muy bien, de repente hace algunos años atrás, no hace mucho, llegaron un conjunto de personas que hicieron toda una campaña xenofóbica, tratando de decir de que los campesinos que estaban ahí no deberían ser campesinos, sino la gente de la ciudad que se llamaba Chongoyape, que ellos eran los verdaderos dueños del territorio. Bueno, de manera bastante sorprendente, esos nombres de estas personas que lideraban toda esta campaña aparecieron en los padrones comunales. Recordemos que las comunidades campesinas son propiedades colectivas, ¿no? Si apareces en las propiedades en el padrón comunal, ya te conviertes en una especie de dueño colectivo de la comunidad. Pero aparecieron en tal cantidad que duplicaron el número de los campesinos originarios. Eran 300 campesinos los comuneros, los que fundaron la reserva, los que tenían la comunidad campesina, y de repente ya eran 900. En ese contexto, en un proceso electoral bastante fraudulento, con una mayoría imposible de arrebatar, ellos tomaron el control legal, entre comillas, de la comunidad. Con una agenda precisa, reducir la reserva, es decir, prácticamente era desaparecerla. Querían desaparecer la reserva, o, en este caso lo que decían formalmente era reducir de 34.000 hectáreas a solo 4.000, ¿no? Todo estaba listo, ya no había nada que hacer. Los campesinos, en su primera sesión que hacen esta nueva directiva de falsos comuneros, de falsos campesinos, la primera sesión que hacen, el primer acuerdo que toman es expulsar a los campesinos de su condición de comuneros, con el riesgo también de perder su territorio y su hogar. A 180 de ellos, o sea, más de la mitad, es una expulsión masiva. Nunca antes se ha visto en la historia de las comunidades campesinas, y todo lo tenían listo. Todos los expulsados eran los líderes de la comunidad, eran los que estaban involucrados en el turismo, los que estaban involucrados en los programas de conservación. No había nada que hacer. Todo era formal. Cualquier denuncia que hacían los campesinos, todas se caían, la fiscalía archivaba las cosas. A pesar de lo evidente y de lo burdo de cómo se había hecho este proceso de ingreso de estos campesinos a los padrones. Allí me involucré yo de manera ya, creo que el elemento para involucrarme se llama indignación. Indignación frente a tanto abuso. Comenzamos primero a tratar de ayudar a los campesinos que denuncien lo que sucedía. Bueno, no pasaba nada. Y ahí cambiamos un poco de estrategia, ¿no? Comenzamos a averiguar qué realmente había detrás de esto. Porque aparentemente lo que ofrecían era, este es un conflicto de campesinos, unos que no tienen tierra y necesitan tierra. Bueno, lo que descubrimos que realmente había toda una red de corrupción que iba desde esta gente que tomó la comunidad hasta lo más alto del poder en el Perú. ¿Qué se estaba sucediendo? Se estaba negociando la construcción de un mega reservorio que se construiría dentro de la zona de reserva, y por lo tanto, primero tenía que perder su condición de reserva para que se pueda construir. Y después de liberar la tierra, bueno, venía el tema de la ampliación de la frontera agrícola. Y había muchos empresarios agroexportadores muy grandes que estaban promoviendo este reservorio. Con una pequeña unidad de investigación, lejos de ya denunciar los abusos o en todo caso, lo víctima que se estaba haciendo de la toma de tierras, etcétera, se comenzó a denunciar una red de corrupción que iba hasta lo más alto del poder. Esto generó una gran, digamos, expectativa de los medios de comunicación. Y yo creo que una de las grandes ventajas que hemos tenido, o uno de los grandes aciertos que ha sido, es que prácticamente logramos atraer a toda la prensa local y nacional. De todos los sectores, desde los más conservadores hasta los más, digamos, progresistas. Todos en la expectativa de qué iba a pasar con los comuneros y una gran presión. Otra de las cosas que aprendimos en esto es que te conviertes en blanco. Es algo que yo nunca había vivido, ¿no? Lo que sucedió, la pequeña organización que tenía se convirtió en blanco, fue la primera que desapareció, fue prácticamente saboteada desde dentro. Tuvimos que hacer otra organización ya con campesinos y voluntarios. Esta vez ya no lo formalizamos para que no sea blanco de lo que nos había sucedido, era una organización no formal. Y es más, ni siquiera le pusimos una estructura piramidal, ¿no? No había un presidente, un vicepresidente, no, había voceros. Entonces, por lo tanto, diluimos la posibilidad de que seamos golpeados. Sin embargo, se dieron, era obvio de que habíamos personas con más relevancia dentro de la organización. Mi propia persona fue blanco de el primer atentado que hubo dentro de todos los que estamos en la defensa contra la vida fue contra mi persona. Fue un atentado en la puerta de mi oficina, me dispararon. Bueno, tuve la suerte de que no me dieran. Además, ya en los mismos procesos de defensa, ya con estas personas que son criminales que han traído también, he sido golpeado. Además, me criminalizaron, tuve una condena de 3 años de cárcel, estuve en prisión por el lapso de 2 meses hasta que mi defensa demostró de que lo que me estaban acusando no era un delito, ni siquiera estaba considerado en el Código Penal. Sin embargo, me sentenciaron. Y lo más gracioso, por decirlo de una manera, es que en el Perú un tema penal, cuando digamos eres una persona que es primaria, que nunca ha cometido un delito, y si es menor de 4 años, no es prisión efectiva. Entonces, mi sentencia fue a 3 años. Sin embargo, me mandaron a la cárcel. Cuando terminaba supuestamente de cumplir la prisión, justamente un mes después de que se acababa todo el derecho que tiene una entidad del Estado de gestionar todo el proceso de negociación por el reservorio. O sea, en conclusión, me querían fuera. Bueno, eso en líneas generales, pero junto conmigo, porque de alguna manera solo uno de un grupo, hay otros 25 compañeros que están en la misma condición, e inclusive personas tan relevantes como el propio presidente del Poder Judicial del Perú, es decir, uno de los hombres que dirigía uno de los poderes del Estado, que decidió tomar importancia en lo que veníamos denunciando, también fue amenazado en su casa el mismo día que fue a visitar la reserva. Entonces, esto habla de la impunidad y de la tranquilidad con que se mueven estos grupos porque se sentían todopoderosos.
Ok. Bueno, gracias. And we'll get back to some issues that you left, that you raised. But let me, if I could ask Selwyn, if you could give us a sense of what you've been doing to challenge corruption and how that has caused threats or other forms of intimidation to limit your work.
Thank you. Firstly, I would like to acknowledge the DTP for bringing me over diplomacy training program in the Pacific to give me a chance to tell the international community what is violation of human rights in the small island states in the Pacific Ocean. I work as a coordinator for the Tawatana Community Conservation. Also, I am a conservation ranger. I work with my ranger colleagues up in the forest. What we did in the communities is we are trying to set up a protected area that is in response to the logging industry that the Chinese companies are doing on our small island. We have 23 companies from China. They are big companies. And whilst we have that issue of logging. We also have the sea level rise eating away our island, and at the same time, we have the threat of logging digging up our island in the middle. So we are protecting the last remaining tropical rainforest on that island. It's 10,000 hectares. And it is the watershed area, supplies water throughout both sides of the island. Solomon Island is the second highest log exporter to China, apart from Papua New Guinea. So it's a very tiny island, and if we supply China with the amount of logs, then you just imagine the pressure we are having. And we don't have a chance to tell the international community what we are facing. So in that, that protected area, we have also the historical sites we have. They are inside that area. And also, we try to register that protected area. Our government has a law, a Protected Areas Act, and it has processes. And we have been struggling to complete that process for 3 years until we just managed to suspend the company on July 16th after 3 years battle. So, we struggled for so long for the 3 years because it was the, we blame the government. The whole system in the government is corrupt. Those 23 companies, only 3 of them have a license. 19 of them do not have a license. Then how does they operate their company? That's a sign of corruption. So we do not know, and when we are doing, we block the roads and the companies, they send the police over, and also the Chinese companies are hiring security firms. So when we try to express our right, we fight with the security officers, and my rangers are injured. And instead for them to, for the police to arrest them, and they arrest us, they say that we are interfering with a legal activity. So anyway, we do not give up. We follow as our concept of settling the our land issues. First, we have a small process because we cannot go against the government. The whole system is against us because the Solomon Islands revenue is only from logging. And if we are against the logging operation, we are against the whole government system. We will have no money, and only logging is the, so we are, and there is lack of enforcement in the, we have laws. We have the forestry sector have laws. The environment have laws. All those, the government, the provincial government have laws, but they do not work in the Solomon Islands. Because if we stop logging, then that means we are stopping the revenue for the Solomon Islands government. So that's how we also, we are campaigning against corruption around the, we are joining the national. So in response to that, and we contribute to our success in removing the logging company, we join with the national CSOs for the Anti-Corruption Act. The government have shelved the Anti-Corruption Act and do not want to pass it in the parliament. So we join with all CSOs and do a protest and then they retable it again. And then it passed the Solomon Island Anti-Corruption Act 2018. So that helped us, and also we advocate for the Whistleblowers Act. That helps us. So we have that Whistleblowers, and we have that Anti-Corruption Act, and helps us with our work. So while our conservation organization, traveling around for awareness and advocacy programs, also we do the, we have an election beginning of the year, the voters awareness, we try to educate the population to vote for the right leaders. So there were once an intending candidate. He owns a large landing craft. We were having an engine problem, and that landing craft came and smashed our boat, and our boat dives underneath that landing craft, and my five rangers jump out in the sea and float for 1 hour. So that's how they hate to they do not want to listen to us, because fighting, we are trying to fight for our rights, but it's hard to address it unless we solve the corruption issue. So that is our situation in the Solomon Islands. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Selwyn, if we can change the focus a bit. We've heard from folks who are involved in the struggle to preserve the environment and push back directly against companies and other governmental interests and dark forces that are threatening and intimidating. I'd like to ask Sharon if you could tell us a bit about your work in uncovering and documenting corruption and publicizing it, and then if you can tell us about the slap suits, in part so we can just get a sense of the use of law or legal frames to intimidate and constrain and restrict the important work you're doing.
But first I have to say that I was really surprised about surprised and honored, but more surprised in the first because of the invitation of me to this convention, because I never thought of myself as a human rights defender. Because when I imagined before I came here, human rights defenders, it's always, you know, about immigration subjects and poor people, of course, and third world countries. And this is none of my expertise. I'm not expert in all these issues. But when I'm thinking about it, maybe I am a little bit human rights defender, because I think, like you said before, that to cover corruption is very important, and now I understand it even better than before I came here, because the battle of human rights is concentrate all the years, I think, for my opinion, if I see from outside, in the politician and the government and the laws against human rights defenders. But behind all those politicians and governments, the more powerful people is the tycoons who have a finance interest. And they make the policy, actually. It's not the politician. The politician is a tool for these powerful people with a lot of money. And so I think it's really important, this panel, and it should be really on the mind all the time. Where is the interest? Why, like you said, why the government chase human rights defenders when they want to say something? And part of it important subject is the freedom of speech, because this tycoon and powerful people, tycoon and government and politicians, are always fighting the freedom of speech. I will tell you a little about my workplace so you can understand what I mean. I'm a journalist for almost 15 years. I was working in the mainstream media in Israel, in all the big, in a big channel TV, in a big TV channel, in a big newspaper. But in the last 3 years, I'm working in an independent magazine site, which called the hottest place in L. And I will, a lot of people ask me, what is it? So I will explain. It's a part of, I want to quote you the full quote. The hottest place in L is a famous sentence that Martin Luther King said in Washington March. He was quoting Dante Alighieri, which said that the hottest place in hell is reserved for those who remain neutral in times of great moral conflict. And this is what we believe in my workplace. So this workplace for me is not hell, it's actually heaven. And what we're doing there is a lot of investigation. And it's a little site, but because we are not a big media, and we don't have big advertising, and we don't have tycoon that holds us, we're free of interest. So we can do a lot of time what journalists supposed to do when they work, to think first about the public interest and not about any interest at all. One of the things I cover the most is the relationship between tycoon and politician, and also the media. Because I think around the world, but especially in Israel, a lot of the media outlet is holding by the big tycoons. And the reason is really interesting, because you know it's like, no, maybe in Israel, a soccer, you have a joke that that if you buy a soccer team, it's never for earning money, it's only for respect. So in the same time, if you buy in Israel a media outlet, something like newspaper or channel, it's never to gain money, because all the media is now struggling to survive with all the, you know, digital issues and the social network. But so this triangle between, so when tycoons in Israel are buying media, they buy it not to earn money, but to affect, to get effect of the public opinion, and to make the policymaker make decision for the sake of their businesses, their other businesses, not the media. And of course, when they buy media, they get an immunity, and you can't write anything about them. So I think this triangle between the media and the tycoons and the government and the politicians is really an important triangle to understand if you want to fight against corruption. So this is the first thing. And actually, if you see in Israel, now there is against the Prime Minister, Benjamin Netanyahu, there is four cases, four investigations of corruption. Three of them involve the media. Okay, in one, he got he suspect that he take money from, no, I'm sorry, that he was bribed by a big tycoon that holds a very big communication company, and also own a site, big site in Israel. that everyone is going into to read about the news. And the bribe was not money. The bribe was positive cover for the prime minister and his family. But you know, I don't, in the lowest button, now you say in the if you think about the consequences, this is a bribe that for a lot of money. Okay, this cover costs money. It's not giving for free. So it's really a bribe, although it's not in an envelope with money. So this is one problem that a lot of media cannot cover things and cover human rights issues because they have interest. So this is a very important place for us, like the hottest place in hell, to become a player and to really reveal all these problems. So beside of this, beside of buying media, another thing that the power people do more and more in the last years, and it's all over the world again, it's to sue people, sue journalists like me, but not only journalists, also activists. And even you know, even the public was publishing something in Facebook or Twitter, and they sue the people. It's not sue, and they don't sue because they want you to take your money. They sue because they want you to be silent, to shut up, and not to talk about corruption, of course, about their corruption. In the last, like you see me. I have three big lawsuits for the amount of almost, like I told you before, €1 million. So I put aside every week. I put €2 in the, you know, in a little box to save it. Okay. And the problem is with the suits, is that. It really makes a lot of people to shut and not to talk. It really affects the freedom of speech. I choose in these three lawsuits to fight back. And it was not an easy fight. And it still is going. Actually, last week, I won one of these lawsuits, big lawsuit. Thank you. The union of the advocates in Israel sued me for a quarter of million euro, because of article I publish two articles I publish about the head of this union, and. You know, when I got sued, everyone told me, give up, go to settle with them. Tell them you won't write again about them, tell them you will maybe raise the article and settle, that's it. And I didn't want to settle because it became, it was systematic for these people to sue and to shut up journalists. So, like I told you last week, I won this suit, but I got, it's not a really success for me, because when people sue you, and okay, the court said you won, but they don't really pay off anything, it's a really big problem. They don't give you a compensation. Because if there is no compensation for these suits, so these people don't really have a problem to sue you. Because, like I said before, they just want to take you to court, to make you lose power, to make you weak, and to make you say, okay, I don't want to mess with them, I don't want to work all the time about this suit, and I prefer to shut up. And you know, when I'm here, I was hearing about a story in the US. I don't know if you know Sheldon Adelson. Do you know him? He's a really a big tycoon in the US, a big casino tycoon. And he's a big friend of Benjamin Netanyahu, the prime minister in Israel, and also all the newspaper, big one in Israel, that is getting for free. And he was suing someone in the US that called him dirty. Okay, the person called him dirty in the Facebook or in an article, I'm not sure, and he's suing for a lot of money. And I just got the news that the court in the U.S. Said he should pay this blogger that called him dirty a lot of money. For compensation. Sheldon will sue him for the slap suit. Right.
But who won?
The blogger.
The blogger won.
The blogger that was sued. And it's really good, yeah. But unfortunately, it's not like this all over the world. In US, there is a strict law against slap suits. But in Europe and in Israel, it's really bad. And we see more and more slap suits against people. So I think this is also a way to threat and to hurt the freedom of speech. And everything like that is something we need to fight against and to cover it. And I think that independent journalism is a good place to do it and to fight against all this financial interest.
Thank you very much. No doubt independent, courageous, and may I say, sometimes headstrong journalists like you, who refuse to settle, are clearly an essential ally of human rights defenders pushing against corruption and for human rights. I'm trying to pay attention to time. I know we're running a bit short. So I wanted to ask Romani, I was going to ask a few follow-up questions, but I'll ask all the questions at once, and then we'll see if we take questions from the public or we have a few from the panel. But Romani, looking as we sort of transitioned to responses or those who are pushing back against corruption, and we have the example of the journalists, and first the example of those in the front lines literally working to advocate for the communities most directly affected. But if you can tell us a bit about the World Bank Inspection Panel, maybe just briefly, what is it, what does it do, what's its remit, and then if you could address the particular issue of what the World Bank can and should do in cases where those who are defending rights are facing intimidation or risk, and how the World Bank can use its leverage, which is quite important, to advance the interests of those who are working for transparency, which should be a core value of the World Bank. So if you can answer those questions, and then we'll see if we toss it out to the floor. And I know we want to make sure we have time for coffee and break and try and get us back on time, right? Yes? I'm looking at, okay. But let me turn it over to Romani, please. Your thoughts on those topics.
So thank you very much. And I'd also like to acknowledge the very powerful and courageous testimonies we've been hearing, because in a sense I sit on the other side, because I represent an accountability mechanism that in a sense gives a voice to people who are fighting for their causes against authoritarian regimes or powerful institutions or organizations, etc. So let me give you a very brief background on who the inspection panel is. So the inspection panel is an independent accountability mechanism of the World Bank Group. So we are independent from management and operations. We are appointed by the World Bank Board, and we report back to the World Bank Board. And the panel was set up in 1993 as an independent complaints mechanism for people who believe they are harmed or they may be harmed by a World Bank project, that they can complain to an independent mechanism. And in a sense, we are also a body that gives voice, therefore, to people who may not otherwise have a voice. And then our role is to then investigate the complaint that is brought to us. So we have a process through which we would investigate, and essentially our reports go back to the board, and then bank management has to respond to the findings of our investigation. So it's a kind of a fact-finding process. And it's all about looking at harm. We look at environmental and social harm and or injustice that has been committed, and we look at the bank's role in it. We are not mandated to look at the borrower. We look at the bank, and has the bank met with its policies or not, as the case may be. So the bank has social and environmental safeguard policies, and they also now have the new environmental and social framework, which are the environmental and social standards. So we also, the other role we have is holding the bank account to its own policies, standards, commitments that it has set out. Now, we have noticed over the last few years an increasing rise of reprisals, threats, intimidation, so those who complain against us. And that has been very noticeable. And in fact, in the last 2 years, almost every complaint that has been brought to us, the complainants have asked for confidentiality. So we offer confidentiality to our complainants, and we have a number of processes in terms of how we protect that confidentiality. But they have asked for confidentiality, and they have also reported recurrent threats, intimidation, reprisals, harassment that they have faced. So what do we do about that? So essentially, as the panel, we assess the risks that a complainant may face, given the context that they may come from, the country context, the geographical context, the political context, etc. But we have a process of assessment, and then we